all for coming to this webinar. It's the first one that I'm attending, actually jointly organized by ICTP and SISSA after this COVID-19 emergency started. And it's part of our intention to restart science and to say that science sort of goes on, and we have to show that intention.
All for coming to this webinar.
The first one
but that also, I would say, a way to
underscore the importance of basic sciences, because when this COVID emergency started, that's when people realized that work in areas like epidemiology, which apparently have were outside of the public discourse, which are statistical physicians are doing for their own reasons, perhaps. Some of the insights from there are important. And so we are very happy to have with us Dr. Luca Ferretti. He is at the Big Data Institute in Oxford, and his research involves an interplay of epidemiology, genetics, evolution, and within host dynamics of HIV and other viral pathogens. So it's a subject that is of particularly interest to us, which can affect policy decisions. So we are very happy to have him here. And I would request Stefano, since Luca has a connection with Trieste and with SISSA, I would request him to say a few words about him.
Sure. So I'm very happy to start this new activity, webinar activity together with ICTP, and also happy that the first speaker is a previous PhD student from SISSA, doing high energy physics, by the way, so now moved to epidemiology. And just a few words saying that, in fact, SISSA moved all its teaching activities at the level of PhDs online after the lockdown. So it has been a very busy time, in fact, in the last month to manage all these activities, and also to manage the work of the administration from at a distance. And another thing I would like to say is that, in fact, since a month, there is a joint group of research between ICTP, SISSA, and University of Trieste, and that we have offered to the regional government our service, and we are waiting that we really start also to apply all the tools, all the most modern tools of basic science to also the data of the epidemic, and that could be very helpful in the phase in which we are going to reopen, for instance, at SISSA, the experimental activities. So that's all, and I leave the floor to the organizers.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefano. Thank you, Atish. So before starting, I would like to just remind a little bit of rules on how to interact. So every participant has the possibility to raise a hand, and at due time, I will give them the floor to ask their questions. With this, I would like also to thank Luca for agreeing to give this seminar. Luca started this adventure with COVID in ICTP because we were starting a program where he was a lecturer. And so today, his talk will be on epidemic control to contact tracing, and in particular the use of apps on mobile phones. And I think this is a particular example where really scientific excellence meets society needs. So I'm very happy that he agreed to give this seminar. So please, Luca.
Thank you very much, Matteo. And thanks to all of you for inviting me to give this seminar. I will share my screen. And possibly adjust the mouse. Okay, so thank you again. My presentation today will concern mostly the scientific aspects of contact tracing in the case of the current COVID-19 epidemic and how these aspects suggest epidemic control via digital contact tracing. I will not discuss so much the privacy features that have been discussed a lot in the current debate. And I will not discuss so much even the social features of this. We can discuss them later in the discussion part if you want. Right now, I would like to focus on the science behind this and what is that we know epidemiologically and why there is this case for digital contact tracing. So first, let me start with a few basic facts about the epidemiology of COVID-19. You all know probably most of this, but just to make some basic points straight. So this is caused by a coronavirus, as you know, SARS-CoV-2, which is very similar to the virus that was causing the 2003 SARS epidemic, with two crucial differences. The first one that is positive, of course, is that usually it causes less severe symptoms. Because essentially the original SARS was a lung infection causing severe pneumonia, while in this case, the infection is more concentrated in the upper respiratory tract, at least in the initial phase. And so it causes milder symptoms in most individuals. On the other hand, this movement from the lung to the upper respiratory tract means also that the infection can be more easily transmitted even before showing symptoms. And this is one of the key of all what I'm going to explain later. The other key feature is that in about one case every five, it causes severe pneumonia, requiring hospitalization and special intensive care. So typically ICU care and ventilation. This is a key feature because the problem of this infection is not the same as the original SARS that was mortality. The problem of this infection is the fact that it overwhelms the ICU departments in hospitals. So essentially you are not so much killing a large number of people by themselves, but you are overwhelming health systems. This is the plot from the celebrated or famigerated Imperial College Report 9 by Neil Ferguson and collaborators that shows how this works and why all the talks about flattening the curve were essentially quite misleading in this context. Here you see different cases for the epidemic. The black curve is doing nothing and the other curves are different kind of interventions, let's say moderate intervention, trying to isolate cases, trying to enhance social distancing and so on. And you see how the epidemic would progress. This is for the UK. And this that you see here at the bottom, this red line, is the critical ICU levels beyond which you cannot ensure any kind of care to the patients. So you see that the problem is not so much that people will die because of intrinsic fatality rate, but people will die because the health system will essentially or would essentially be put in a condition not to work anymore. And no matter how strongly you try to flatten the curve, the truth is that to avoid this scenario, you have to smash this curve completely. That is why we are all in lockdown, basically. Now, keeping this in mind, a key point is acting on this epidemic as strong as possible and as fast as possible. From the epidemiological point of view, however, there is another issue. That is that in a growing epidemic of a novel virus for which you know absolutely nothing and you have scarce information, even doing epidemiology is difficult. So, just to give you an example, here there is a plot of the growth rates in China, in Wuhan. This is, if you see this at the very beginning of the epidemic, or at least when the first cases appeared. You see, and there are different sets of cases. You see here in blue, here in red, these are counts of cases, and deaths are here in violet. And you can see that depending where you look, there are different regimes of exponential growth, more or less for the same kind of situation, or at least if you want, it's not clear which one to choose, that give very different results in terms of what is the growth rate of the virus. So even one of the simplest quantities is the doubling time, so how long it takes for the epidemic to double its size. It's not so easy to infer. And actually, there are different predictions even in this context, depending essentially which part of these curves you trust. I personally trust this one that is about essentially a growth rate of 10% each day. But this is debatable, and there is a lot of debate even about those data. The situation is even less clear in Europe, because while growth rates in China are at least a bit better understood, in Europe and, for example, in Italy, the growth rate seems to be higher, and there is significant uncertainty over which is the actual values and how strong a certain bias is. But if you see, for example, the values for Veneto, that is considered to be one of the regions in Italy with the best surveillance, you see that in this log scale, the growth of the epidemic is significantly faster than the one that I just picked for Wuhan, that is this dotted line. So the growth of the epidemic in Italy, I'm looking at the number of hospitalized cases, but this should not make a big difference. So the growth rate in Italy and in more generally in Europe seems to be even faster than our initial prediction for China. And this, of course, is a major issue for public health. Now, when we started this work, it was clear to us that in order to tackle this growth, you need to decompose it into different kind of transmissions. And we proposed something like an epidemiological classification of transmissions mode for this virus that is not related so much to the physical classification, but it's related more to the epidemiology, and so the ways you can stop different ways of transmission. So the four ways are symptomatic, that is essentially that people transmit it directly via droplets and saliva after the onset of symptoms. Presymptomatic, that means that they do the same, but when they still don't show any symptom. Asymptomatic, that is the case of these people that will never show symptoms at all. They are infected, they are able to transmit, but either they don't have symptoms or the symptoms are so mild that are actually impossible to assess properly, except by a test, of course. A direct antigen testing could still reveal those cases. And then there is the environmental route that was very important for the original SARS epidemic in 2003, for example, in Hong Kong. So you can spread this virus, for example, by leaving droplets while speaking out of your mouth. These droplets fall on some surface. They're called fomites. And then people touch this surface, they touch their face, for example, then after that, and they get the virus indirectly this way. The same thing can occur to ventilation systems, for example, in other ways. So this is another important route that was to be explored. Initially, we thought that these two routes could have been the key for the epidemic. So that was our prior. And we found out that to the best knowledge of the literature, that is not precisely the case. Asymptomatic cases are probably a large number. The best estimates come from Volgano in Italy, a study by Andrea Cresanti and collaborator, that estimates about 40%, 45% of people that are essentially completely asymptomatic. But other more detailed studies of infectiousness for these people show a significantly lower infectiousness compared to severe symptoms. So we are talking about maybe 10%, 20% of the infectiousness of mild or severe cases. So large number, but probably little contribution to the overall epidemic, although this is very much uncertain right now. Environmental doesn't look like, except for the one market that was the original super spreading event, doesn't look like other environmental transmissions play a major role in the epidemic. They could play some role, but most of the epidemic looks like it's driven by household transmission, close contacts with friends and colleagues and so on. So, and the best estimate right now is maybe 10%, although this is very, very uncertain because it's difficult to assess in a non-epidemic. Now, sorry, the matter is therefore how many transmissions are symptomatic and how many are pre-symptomatic. To do this, you have to compare two different numbers, roughly speaking. One is the incubation period, that is the time that takes from when you get infected to when you show symptoms. And the second one is the so-called generation time or serial interval. It is the time between two different infections of the virus. So the time it takes the virus to jump from a first host that gets infected to a new one. The comparison between these two numbers is essentially determining how many transmissions are pre-symptomatic or symptomatic. If the incubation period is longer than the generation time, you have pre-symptomatic transmission. If it's shorter, you have symptomatic ones. The first step that we did was trying to reinfer based on all the data that we could get the generation time distribution. The incubation time was already studied in several studies. The generation time was unclear for several reasons that have to do with the epidemiology of the epidemiological inference. So what I did was essentially going through hundreds of cases in the literature and in newspapers and accounts by different health authorities, and select in the end the small fraction of cases. It's about 40 cases that had sufficient information about the times of exposure and the onset of symptom, both from the infector and for the infected individual. And then infer what you see here, that is the generation time. So here in red, you can see the distribution of incubation time. So it takes about 5 days in general to show symptoms. In blue, you see our best estimate, this is our viable distribution for the generation time. So the time it takes to infect someone else. And you see that both curves look very similar. Of course, there is a large uncertainty outlined here in gray with the generation time distribution. But there is a quite strike pattern. It is at the beginning, the generation time distribution, no matter what is the uncertainty, grows much faster than the incubation time one. That means the generation time tends to be shorter, to have a shorter tail with respect to incubation time. This means pre-symptomatic transmission. And you see that if you change the curve to different estimates, like this is a viable, this is a gamma, this is a log normal, it changes the peak, it changes some feature of the curve, but this feature of pre-symptomatic transmission does not change so much. And this is the direct, essentially, this is the Bayesian posterior on all the cases. And you see that you have some cases of clearly symptomatic transmission and but quite some cases that favor pre-symptomatic transmission. And our estimate is from the posterior distribution of the average is that 30-45% of all transmissions from cases that will eventually become symptomatic are actually pre-symptomatic, and so they cannot be detected. This is in line with all posterior results. So most recent estimates that are appearing in the literature are about 40-45%. The other important role, and the kind of important quantity to keep always in mind in an epidemic is the reproduction number, R naught or R that you will have heard for sure in the recent times. This is the classical way to understand if you can reach epidemic control. Basically, R naught is the average number of infections caused by an infected individual if the population would be naive. So if there will be no one else in the population and that's all. While if you have some interventions or if a part of the population is immune and so on, you have something like an effective reproduction number, that is R. And the critical condition under which you can say that your epidemic is controlled, either because of immunity or of interventions, is R less than one. So this is the critical number that is always touted as the way to stop pandemics. And this is a general principle of epidemiology. So basically the only number that you should really focus on if you want to stop the epidemic in the long term is this R. Now, how do you get this now? Because what you get usually in the epidemic is the growth rate. So how many new cases per day compared to the cases that you had yesterday. Now, the relation between these two numbers is through a series of equations that are the classical renewal equation that just tells you, given the cases in the past, how many cases you are gonna get today. If you have some infectiousness in time, it is if each of these individuals have a given profile of infectiousness in time, that is this beta, that is basically R not time degeneration time distribution. Now, if you take this equation, it is the renewal equation, so it's a sort of next generation equation, if you want, to pass from one generation of infection to the next one, and you add some kind of exponential ansatz with a growth rate R, you get an equation for R naught and the generation time distribution and the growth rate. That is the so-called Euler-Lotka equation that essentially tells you that via the generation time distribution, you can pass from the growth rate to R naught and vice versa. So the generation time distribution is also key to understand what is actually R naught in the epidemic. For the current epidemic, there is a wide range of estimates due to the uncertainty from about 2.5 to 4. But let's say that for Italy, the best guess right now is 33.5, although there is a lot of uncertainty on this. Now, let's go back to our classification in four different routes. What we can do is to try to decompose the infectiousness, that is, how infectious is an individual in time after infection, in different contributions across these four different routes. So for example, the symptomatic contribution will be some kind of infectiousness profile, time the fraction of asymptomatic individuals, times the probability these individuals of these individuals. The pre-symptomatic will have some term that is one minus the cumulative probability that they ever had symptoms at time tau. Symptomatic will be the same related to the probability they already had symptoms by this time tau. And the environmental will contain a delay function because the environmental is essentially a kind of infection into the environment and then an indirect transfer of the virus delayed in time. So you can essentially decompose this infectiousness in all these four components and put the values to the best of our knowledge. This is what we did. And this is the final result. So this overall curve is the curve of infectiousness, is the generation time that you have seen before, essentially. And different colors correspond to the contribution of the different routes. You can see that, as I told you, our best estimates for environmental asymptomatic are quite small. But what's interesting is that essentially pre-symptomatic transmission and symptomatic transmissions are comparatively stronger. Actually, pre-symptomatic is even having a higher effect here. And the key thing is that by itself, pre-symptomatic transmission is enough to sustain the epidemic almost by itself. So pre-symptomatic transmission is a major issue here in this epidemic. And this is one of the main reasons why we can stop it. Now, the idea is, how can we stop it? Now, one of the classical tools of epidemiology is contact tracing that works like that. Let me illustrate how an epidemic spreads. So you have an individual that is infected. This individual has some physical contacts and let's say close range contacts with different people. He or she infects some of these people. Some of these people have further contacts and go on infecting others and so on. And then with time, these individuals will keep on infecting others and others. And this is how the uncontrolled epidemic works. If you had contact tracing, the difference is that at some point you could detect one of these individuals. For example, you detect that this one is a case by testing or by this individual who goes to the doctor and says, okay, I have these symptoms and so on. What you can do is to validate the fact that he is infected, to find some of its contacts. You will not be able to find all of its contacts, but at least some of them, and to quarantine these contacts at home or somewhere else in such a way that they cannot spread further. And the result is that, of course, the epidemic stops here, or at least you reduce the actual effective reproduction number of the epidemic. Now, just to give you a glimpse of what's the math behind that and what we did, just a glimpse. Don't get too afraid because of this. So the classical equations to describe this kind of system are the Kenmare-McKendrick equations for a chain of infections with contact tracing. They work this way: you have a crucial quantity is the time, the number of people who are infected at time t, having been infected tau days ago, by individuals who were in turn infected tau prime days ago. So this follows essentially two steps of infection. And you have one equation that is this one that essentially describes the time shift invariance of the system. So that the number of people who were actually infected at some point do not depend on the fact that you shift the time forward. So if you want, the past cannot influence the future. Sorry. The future cannot change the events that occurred past. I mean, the other equation is a sort of renewal equation, or better, next generation equation. So if you have what happened until now in terms of transmissions, you can do one step further, move to the next generation of transmissions, and write the equation for the next generation in terms of the past ones. And this equation contains two important contributions that we have to keep in mind because they are important in practice. One is the efficiency of isolation of contact of cases. So if you go here, you have to isolate this case before it spreads further and further and further. So how effective is this? Of course, it's going to have some impact on the way the epidemic spreads. But the second one is how effective you are in contact tracing and quarantining the other individuals. So there are two steps. You have to find them, and you can lose some. And you have, of course, to quarantine them. Otherwise, they will go on spreading anyway. So this term is the efficiency of the isolation of cases, and this is the efficiency of contact tracing, quarantining of contacts. You can plug an exponential growing ansatz into these equations, and what you get is a generalization of the Euler-Locke equation. That is, in this case, it's a functional generalization because it becomes an eigenvalue equation, basically corresponding to the renewal equation, but now it's an eigenvalue equation with eigenvalue one for this linear operator that you see here that contains the growth rate after contact tracing. So the idea is that if you solve the eigenvalue equation for this operator with eigenvalue one, you are essentially solving for this growth rate after the contact tracing in terms of what is the infectiousness of the virus before contact tracing. That is this beta here. Not only this, but if you assume that after contact tracing you want to stop the epidemic, you can just put the final growth rate to zero. That means essentially that you are stopping the epidemic at that point. And you can ask, what is the biggest effective reproduction number that I can stop with a given efficiency just by solving this equation without this term, again, for an eigenvalue of one. And this gives you the maximum R0 that I can actually stop with the contact tracing only with this accuracy. And this is the final result essentially of our science paper, that is the COVID-19 epidemic really controllable via realistic contact tracing? So taking into account delays in time and finite efficiency. Well, the good news is that if you have little delays, you have quite a good window of efficiency in isolating cases and in quarantining contacts, that is here, where you can keep a decently sized epidemic under control. So if you are on this line of efficiency, essentially, you keep an epidemic of R0 equal 2 under control by contact tracing alone with no delay. But if contact tracing takes time, it takes days to operate, of course, you start moving towards a regime where you see that your green area, the area where you can control the epidemic, becomes smaller and smaller and disappears after 3 days, essentially. So after 3 days, even with an R0 of 2, that is a quite optimistic case, you cannot control the epidemic anymore by contact tracing. So this is the key result. The reason is the following. Pick a symptomatic case. So this is the profile of infectiousness, and this is more or less when the case feels the symptoms and wants at that point to be tested and so on. Now, if you wait to trace contacts, you are in the scenario where the contacts who were infected around here have already been through most of their infections in turn. So you can stop the contacts, but they've already infected others and the epidemic goes on. If you are fast enough, you have still some margin to stop the contacts from transmitting when they are still in this range of the infectiousness profile. And so it's quite early and they have not transmitted the infection that far. So let me recall this part because it's really important. Isolation and contact tracing can stop the epidemic actually, or can, let's say, slow down it effectively, only with high efficiency and short response times. So you need to be in this regime. Let's say that you need to be a bit, at least here. So here it means essentially more than 50% of the population using it, definitely. Sorry, more than 50% of the efficiency, both in contact tracing and quarantining. But this is instantaneous. If you wait 3 days, you don't have much chance to make contact tracing work alone. And this is the reason why we had our mind focused on digital solutions. So let me recap the other tools of classical epidemiologists against COVID-19, because it's important to compare to the other interventions that are around. The most immediate one is physical distancing, isolation, and quarantine. Note that this one is, if it's done with via classical contact tracing or if it's done in lockdowns, it's either insufficient if it's done via classical contact tracing, or it has very high social and economic costs if you do it via a generalized lockdown like we are doing now. This is not sustainable. It's very good from the epidemiological point of view. The virus is being stopped, but it's not sustainable in the long term. The alternative is, of course, doing rapid mass screening and testing and contact tracing. In principle, of course, as you have seen, contact tracing, even the classical one, would work against the virus. But you need to be very fast and very effective. And this means scaling a response that is that depends on human resources, that is human contact tracers, people that go around and interview cases and ask them, oh, who did you meet in the last week? Can you give us their contacts so that we can call them and tell them, please quarantine yourself because you're in danger and so on and so forth. This is time consuming and also human resource consuming. There is also the lab capacity for mass screening and testing. That is an important point. It's not only lab capacity, but you need also a rapid response. You need a logistic that allows you to get the results of the test in a very short time, 1 day, 2 days at most, because otherwise, again, the whole process will never work. So this is possible, but very hard to scale effectively in an emergency. The other obvious response is vaccination. It's what we are all waiting for. The truth is that, to be honest, there are not many successful vaccines against coronaviruses. This has to be said. There are about, I think, more than 100 vaccine projects and maybe more than 80 that have some chances to get to the trial phase right now. But it will take time for a massive development and trial phase. And it will need time to scale up production. Bill Gates has suggested, rightly so, to essentially build the factories for all these vaccines right now while they are being tested, because we will not have the time to respond to that. And the factories are less expensive than waiting some more time to respond to the virus. So essentially, its proposal is speed up this part by building the factories now and then using only the ones that you will need. We are at this point of emergency, to clarify the issue. But you cannot shorten the trial phase too much because you need to know what are the consequences of these different vaccines on humans, of course. Because even a small fraction of collateral effects on a vaccine that is distributed to the whole population could have very large consequences. So right now, what we have right now is not much. And digital technologies have the advantage that they are fast and scalable. And these are two key issues that a solution right now has to address. Our proposal is essentially to use mobile apps for contact tracing. They would work this way. So you have some individual, this A, that is infected, no symptoms when it's screened. So of course at home, he or she will have contact with other individuals. And this contact will be recorded via Bluetooth communication between phones, basically. So their mobiles will have exchanges via Bluetooth low energy protocols, and they will know that they have been in proximity of each other with a range of a few meters. That is the typical range for the spread of this virus. This will be the same on the train or on public transport. A will exchange messages. Well, the mobile of A will exchange messages with C and D. At work, it will exchange messages with the people who are close to him. And possibly there can be cases where there are people that are nearby, but occasionally with the, you know, short encounters or a bit farther away. So the individuals that will have a lower proximity score, if you allow me the point. Then again at home. The second day, A awakes with fever. And of course, he or she calls the GP, asks for advice about his or her symptoms, possibly requests a test, gets the test, and it tests is positive. At that point, via the app, you can instantaneously tell all these people that he met closely, look, you are a contact of an individual that has been tested positive and you are close contact and potentially at risk. Please self-isolate yourself for 14 days or whatever is the kind of period that the public health authorities deem reasonable. And moreover, in some cases where there are people for which you are not sure that they are at risk or not, like these individuals, you can advise social distancing. So you can have an amber code where you tell them, look, you are a potential contact of a case. Maybe you are a low risk, but please keep physical distancing wherever in your home interactions, in your work interaction, avoid more general social interaction and so on for a given period of time. So not isolating these individuals, but at least slowing down their physical interactions with others. An important point that has been misrepresented a lot is that this is useful at all phases of the epidemic, because at all phases of the epidemic, you need to reduce R below one. That doesn't matter. What changes is what do you want to do with the cases? So the kind of public health response and the way the apps interacts with public health could change depending on the phase of the epidemic. But if you're at the beginning of the epidemic, you want to have R less than one to prevent the initial spread from growing, of course. If you are at the top of the epidemic, instead of having a lockdown, that is a very dangerous situation in terms of economy and social costs, you can at least try to have a smart lockdown. That is using these kind of apps with very permissive parameters in order to lock down all the people that look even at low risk, but not everybody for all the time. So you will have maybe a significant part of the population at home in actual lockdown or quarantine all the time, but not everybody. And this could help keeping the economy afloat, for example. It is useful for a smart exit. That is, again, a different scenario than the one that we are facing. So we want the cases to get down, and we want to be ready to prevent a second wave in case there will be. No one knows what the second wave will look like and when. So the point is that the app gives you a system to eventually tune the response, depending on how you choose the parameters, and ensure that maybe if the smart exit goes smoothly, everything is fine. If the smart exit doesn't go well, you can move to the smart lockdown phase again. And then, of course, you want to use it at the very end of the epidemic, because there could still be reintroduction from other countries or other local outbreaks, and you want to control the residual spread at the end of the epidemic. Let me outline challenges then, because there are many challenges to this idea. One is the limitation in smartphone coverage, of course, because for the moment only smartphone users can use it, and contact technologies. So the kind of common choice right now of essentially all positives Bluetooth low energy, but there could be a need to integrate, for example, multiple technology. So for example, to allow people who do not have a phone or who do not want to install the app on their phones to have another dongle that will play the same role but being separated from the phone. This is completely possible and many countries are actually thinking about it. So for a few euros or pounds or dollars, you can buy something that essentially has the same functions. It the key feature is that it requires a very high uptake at population level. So it requires a very high effectiveness. And as you can expect, the efficiency of the contact tracing process is quadratic because both the person that is infected and the contacts must have the app in order to be traced. So this requires a very high uptake because the uptake scales quadratically. And this in practice means that more than half of the population should have the app installed or a similar dongle with them. So this is a key challenge because at present it's not clear that this will be the case. I'll discuss it in a moment. Also, this tool is not a miracle, of course. Does not play any kind of weird games, technological games. This is just a tool to tell the people, look, you have been in contact with someone who is infected. Please stop the infection further, self-isolate yourself. So the compliance with this recommendation is not necessarily enforced and is key. So this requires not only a large uptake, but a large adherence to the public health indications in this respect. Also, this is honestly less effective if you do not have good and rapid diagnostic testing. And I mean antigen testing to know who is infected right now. So a scale up of this kind of tests, especially on the speed of these tests across Europe, is actually needed. Moreover, as I have explained before, the European epidemic appears to be a bit faster in growth than we expected. So probably this will be on the top of a series of other interventions, including some basic degree of physical distancing. So no one should think that the app again has some miracle role that allows us to go around and party all day. This will not be the case. I mean, it's an instrument to keep the virus under control, but you need on the top of that some basic degree of physical distancing and of prevention measures to avoid the spread of the virus again. Also, this is a new idea and being realized in a very short time. So I expect there will be the need for a lot of iterative improvements, both of the front end of the app and the back end, and the science, the technology behind that, because we are still starting doing this, essentially. It's like a very large scale experiments done in an emergency. Something especially important are the ethical issues. Not as important as the role they played in the current debate, but they are for sure one of the key features. So the first thing that we did as a group when we had this idea and we wanted to spread this proposal, this epidemiological proposal, was essentially to get in touch with one of the professors in medical health at the University of Oxford and involve him in the project and this group in the project, to make sure that we were not stepping into something too dangerous and that ethically we were on the right side to propose this. The key ethical reason is that contact networks represent highly sensitive personal information, is who we are meeting. It's in some sense, what is our social network? It is a very, very sensitive piece of personal information for all of us. And it's an information highly looked after by both some governments and companies. So it's also very delicate from several perspectives. So there is a need to build trust and confidence at every stage. And this is difficult in the middle of epidemic, to be honest. Privacy and data usage concerns should be at the forefront. So you should be reasonably sure that the mechanism behind the app is robust and does not allow stealing this data quite easily or misusing this data and misusing the app itself. The algorithm, since it's something so relevant, should be transparent and auditable, possibly open source. That is essentially what everyone is proposing. So honestly, no one likes to trust this data to an algorithm that is not publicly scrutinized. there should be careful consideration of digital deployment strategies for specific groups, because, for example, healthcare workers need different strategies. Elderly people quite often do not have a phone or don't have a smartphone. They require different strategies. Young children require different strategies. Again, they do not have a smartphone. And elderly and young people play special roles in this epidemic. Like now, it looks like children are not a major driver, but elderly people are a major driver. And actually what is called a core group, a group that has a high spreading within it and also high fatality and high rate of ICU hospitalizations. So there are details depending on who is the person, who is the social group that is being targeted. And something that is, of course, quite given for granted, although it's not necessarily the case, is that this should be deployed with individual consent. So the adherence to this app should be voluntary. Now, voluntary uptake of the app is a challenge. So there were several studies done across European countries. This is for the UK. To the question, and this is pre-lockdown actually, to the question, would you install the app? As you can see, the kind of results are encouraging in the sense that we would reach maybe around 80% of users of the app, even before the lockdown. After lockdown, there is a slight growth and you probably get to an even higher uptake. The compliance with the app recommendation to self-isolate would be probably reasonably high. You can see that you cannot even read here the labels, I would not comply and so on. And if this is linked to testing, this would be even more likely. Why people want to install the app? For the obvious reasons. The app is an instrument actually to protect friends, to protect relatives, to protect other people, because you know that you are at risk, and so you can put in place all the measures to protect the people around you. So the app does not benefit you in a direct way, but benefits everyone around you. So if you are at risk as a contact, you cannot protect yourself. If you have been infected, there's nothing that the app can do. The app is to spread the epidemic, to stop the spread of the epidemic around you. So of course, you see that the reason is mostly protect family and friends, responsibility towards the community and so on. And the reasons why people are scared of the app are also the quite obvious ones. So it's a kind of data that is quite sensitive. And so there is a concern that this data will be misused after the epidemic or during the epidemic. There is a significant amount of people, surprising enough, do not want the app because it would make them feel anxious. I had chats with such people, and this is a bit of a challenge, but it doesn't look like it's a major effect overall in the uptake. Now, all I discussed is a bit a theoretical model based on the equations that I showed you before, and therefore it assumes a lot of simplifications, like, for example, randomly mixing population, no heterogeneities, no details about the contact networks, and so on and so forth. So to be able to offer a more realistic assessment of what is needed right now, we built a model, OpenABM COVID-19, which is actually freely available. So we are not publicizing it for several reasons so much. The main reason is that we want to be completely open about the model, and we have been advised not to make public much, because there is a possibility of misuse of the model as well. So the model is actually public for all researchers who are interested in using it, improving it, and testing it. It's all open source. It's an agent-based model to evaluate the intervention, especially the app. We started by evaluating different scenarios, mostly tailored to the needs of the English NHS. So the national health system in England is the one with whom we are collaborating more closely to develop the app for Britain. And there are several scenarios depending on what you say, how intensively you want to use the app, what is the actual algorithm for tracing and so on. And you see that in general, if you have a quite high uptake of the app, so around 80%, in several of these scenarios, you can essentially flatten the epidemic and control it. Now, this corresponds to 8% of smartphone users, that, and this excludes elderly and children. So this is about 56% of the UK population. That is not so far from our previous estimates with the simplified model. Here there are similar measures depending on the uptake for the number of deaths. So what would be the way the number of deaths depend on the uptake of the app? And same for the time to the next lockdown, because we all need to be aware that there could be a second lockdown, because if we get out of the first and the epidemic goes again, there will be a second one. This is actually something that is not thought to be so unlikely. And you see that in some regimes, the apps are even able to stop the lockdown, or let's say at least increase significantly the times between different lockdowns. I will say a couple of words about recent developments that I would not like to say, but I think it's right to comment on them. So there have been many, many privacy preserving projects across the world, maybe more than 10 for sure, probably around 15. Currently, they are mostly concentrated about two approaches that I will not even discuss because I think the debate there is completely off the mark. But the idea is that there is PPPPT versus a series of consortia. So this is European, and the P3T is also European, basically Swiss. Then there is TCN Impact, that are US-based consortia. The only thing they have in common right now is the choice of technology. Well, the focus on privacy preserving, of course, approaches, and the common choice of technology in terms of the Bluetooth low energy, because this is pretty much the only protocol that has been seen to work or that could work in given the epidemiological requirements. This makes interoperability and roaming possible. So that's an important point in order to be able to move to other countries and so on. There is some progress in the development of the app at the European level. I am personally involved with three different countries, and there are different countries at different speed. Some of them have already come out with the app, for example, Norway. Some of them I expect to come out with the app in a few weeks. There has been also given an announcement by Google and Apple together that they would embed contact tracing APIs directly in the operating system, so within iOS and Android. This is good in the sense that it gives a lot more power to the app for several reasons, and it solves a lot of issues, also technical issues related to the way the app works within the mobiles. But it has both technical privacy and security pros and cons that I would not like to discuss. But let's say the whole scenario is quite confused at present. The most disquieting thing, in my opinion, is that there is, if you read the public discussion, there is still little trace of epidemiology and public health. They should be the main considerations in the debate. So essentially, the two main considerations are being pushed out of the debate. And this is something that I really feel it's a mistake. That is why I wanted here to focus on the science, to explain why this proposal is out and what's going on. We came out recently as a response to this, to some epidemiological and public health requirements, but I will not go through this in details unless there is a specific question. Just a few final comments. So app-based contact tracing could potentially control the epidemic, and it's pretty much the only response that is fast and scalable. And for this reason, it should be at the core of the epidemic response for an emergency. If this epidemic, when you get out of the lockdown, disappears by itself, we don't need the app, and we are all happy that we can not install it and so on. But if the epidemic at some point goes back again, in an emergency, you need it, because you don't have many other approaches, and many countries are just not ready. There is a lot of work to do on the side of the app to, for example, optimize the contact tracing algorithms. And this is something where theoretical physicists and statistical physicists can say a lot. And learning from the contact network itself and from the case that you see. This is, again, a very hot topic, I think, in statistical physics and theoretical physics. I repeat, you need the public support, public trust. You need high uptake and high compliance. So these are critical. Otherwise, the app will just not work. There's no way. The other important point that I would like to remark is that I've been talking only about the app, but it's not thought to be a standalone solution. just because we do not know enough about this epidemic to put all our cards on the app and forget about the rest. So it needs an integrated strategy that tries to avoid risk on all sides. So epidemiological surveillance, forecast of possible risks, community testing to detect outbreaks preemptively, tracking where the hotspots are, and then doing possibly manual contact tracing, increased testing, and possibly local lockdowns where the outbreaks are and where the hotspots for the virus are. And of course, there's a lot to discuss how the app plays with these other interventions and how it interfaces with the public health system. This should have been a part of the discussion or the public debate that has been absent, unfortunately. Widespread rapid diagnostic testing is key because otherwise the app is underpowered and there's a lot of issues if you just cannot test people. And physical distancing will be still important. So I expect some degree of social interactions again, but I do not expect life to go back to normal, even with the app. I mean, the app can give you some extra safety, but some basic norms of social distancing, like covering your face, maintaining not so close contacts, reducing mass gatherings and so on will be in place probably for a while. So thanks a lot. All this work is based on our paper in Science and a report that you can find at this address. So we are trying to collect there both are kind of layman point of view on the epidemic and the technical materials. So you'll find everything at this in this web page. And thanks again for listening.
Okay, thank you very much, Luca. So we have time for a few questions. We have Adrian. I don't know whether he's still with us.
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice presentation. I just had two quick questions, if I may. The first was on the transmission pathways. At the beginning, you said that environmental transmission was only around 10%. So I was wondering, there's been a big flurry of people trying to find environmental sensitivities of the virus to climate, some of which have been, I'm going to say, rather poor, but nevertheless. I was wondering then, if the environmental transmission is such a small proportion, does it mean that we can't expect to have a big seasonality in cases, even if there's a strong climate sensitivity to the disease in the environment? And very quickly, the second one is your agent-based model is very nice. I was just wondering how you make the assumptions about contacts, the distribution of contacts per person inside your model, because again, that needs a lot of information, should we say, that might be available from phones, but again, it's difficult to get. Thank you.
So on the first point, seasonality is a debated matter. There are some results that suggest seasonality, and I think they are reasonably strong, but this is the same also for other coronaviruses, so I'm not surprised. The matter is how strong is seasonality. And seasonality is not only a matter of be careful, seasonality is not only a matter of the environment, so how long the virus lasts on surface, so environmental transmission. Seasonality also means a change in social interactions.
Exactly.
So people go around in a different way, in different seasons, when it's hot and so on. There's also a change in the kind of response of the lungs, actually, and the respiratory tract to the viruses, because the respiratory tract tend to get less inflamed, for example, in summer and so on. So it's a multifaceted point. So there are evidences that there is some effect. For all coronaviruses, pretty much there is some effect. We do not know how strong, and this is the key question, not so much that there is, but is it a small effect or is it a very relevant one? And since we do not even know precisely which part is involved, it's difficult to say something. So it's not only the environmental part, it would affect also the susceptibility of people, it would affect in a complex way all those transmissions. On the other hand, if it's hot, you have, for example, a lot of forced ventilation because you have air conditioning. So things are not black and white. Unfortunately, it's quite complicated. I would also emphasize that our trust on the estimate of environmental transmission is still poor because still people do not understand how strong this contribution could be. It doesn't look like it's major because there is little anecdotal evidence in some sense, but working out So let's say it's minor compared to SARS, to the classical SARS. We do not know how strong it actually is. It could make some slight difference. In direct transmission, so environmental one via, for example, food. So if we are in a dinner with friends or with family, droplets fall into the other dishes and the other people pick them and get infected. This is counted here as a direct transmission because in practice epidemiological, you have a gathering of people close by. This is an important route. So if you call this environmental, this is really important. So dinners and meals with friends and family have been shown in China by the London School to be an important effect, for example. Second point on the ABM. The ABM, in short, there is a 2008 publication on social network interactions in workplaces, households, and random interactions. That is by Mosson-Tal. It is pretty much the only complete paper we know. There is actually a series of other small data sets around, well, not so small data sets around, that are being currently investigated. So there is social patterns and there are other data sets of real life interactions. We use this 2008 paper. The question is that we do not know the dispersion there. So this, how spread it is and how good is the Bluetooth, for example, measuring. This is something that is being experimented right now in military bases, in several military bases actually, to understand how the signal correlates to distance and how many false negatives and false positives you have. It doesn't look to be so bad right now, but how the precision affects is not yet in the model. We'll be probably in a version soon.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you very much. So there are several questions. So another one from Marcello.
Hello, hi. So thank you very much. I have a rather simple question, which is based on your initial assumptions. So what is the sensitivity of the impact of the tracing that you have discussed if I change considerably the asymptomatic transmission? Like, I don't know, if I put it down to 2% or if I put it up to 30%.
So asymptomatic transmission is basically something that is complicated because you do not trace it at the level of... So you can, of course, stop contacts who are asymptomatic, but if you have a case that is asymptomatic, you will never find it. So the point is, if the overall contribution of asymptomatic transmission grows above probably 20-30% of our knot, it becomes a major contribution that contact tracing cannot stop even with very high efficiency both in finding cases and contacts. So I think there is some hard limit. We haven't studied it yet, basically because there was until recently not much evidence of a large number of asymptomatics. I mean, lots of talking about it, but the first real evidence has been, I think, with the paper of Andrea Cresanti that recently appeared in MedArchive, that is precisely the essentially testing all the population of boy organeo in Italy. And so they find very high values, about 40% that are symptomatic. That are, by the way, the same values that we chose for our science paper. So I was not too surprised.
Sorry, on this number, do you think if this has a strong age difference, like for instance, kids transmit a lot when they are asymptomatic and old are not, I mean, this can still help contact tracing somehow? Can make it more useful?
So the point is, I think in Andrea Cresanti's data, it's about flat across age groups. I am not 100% sure, but I think they don't find big difference among age groups. Kids appear to get the disease less and transmit it less. So it's not that they're asymptomatic, actually. They're apparently less susceptible and less transmissive. So that's the current evidence. That's why actually some countries like the NED, I don't have the plot here, but there is a report for the Dutch parliament a couple of days ago that was showing very clearly that essentially kids don't matter. And so, in fact, the Dutch parliament has essentially decided, as far as I understood, to reopen schools for this reason. But yeah, I mean, asymptomatics is some of, to be honest, asymptomatics is some of the things that are worrying me most epidemiologically. And that is why I think that contact tracing alone is a risk. So you have to do community testing and other measures to cover yourself from the fact that this may be transmissibility of asymptomatic people. So infectiousness is higher than you expect. This is one of the reasons why I was saying integrated strategy, because you cannot put all your eggs in a basket if you don't know enough about the epidemic.
Yes, asymptomatics are a little bit like a dark matter in epidemiology.
Yeah, precisely. At this point,
so I would say, question, yeah. We have a question from Rajiv. And I think we should cut this in 5-10 minutes at most.
I'm here. Please ask questions if you want to go on. Yeah.
Thank you for the illuminating discussion and providing the realistic method about curbing this pandemic. I was wondering how the developing country like India, with billions of people, with limited resources also, they can get some benefit from using this fantastic approach?
It's a complicated matter. The answer is, I think so. And even more, I think that essentially countries like India would benefit, especially because other approaches are essentially impossible. So the little benefit that maybe the app can give locally is pretty much one of the biggest ones. Now, for developing countries, there are two kinds of countries, essentially. Countries that have a decent smartphone coverage that they can use the app. And to my understanding, this is the case for most parts of India. So at least in many parts of India, you could have local pockets where smartphone coverage is high enough that you can actually use the app if you essentially ask everybody to install it. There are countries, unfortunately, where it's not the case. So if your smartphone covers 40% of the population, the app will unfortunately never work. That's the point. So my point, and honestly, the issue is very different if you look at Latin American countries, African countries, or for example, countries like India. India has also the advantage of having anyway some kind of health system that could support the app. So my idea is that for India, this could be useful. My suspicion is that the situation in India is a bit peculiar because you will end up with patches with very high maybe coverage and patches or say regions or areas with very poor one. This has a double effect. You can essentially block the epidemic in the areas with quite good coverage. At the same time, in the other areas, it will go on uncontrolled. And how these two things balance each other, it's a different matter. And Singapore knows that very well, because in Singapore you had precisely this scenario. So the normal population is not seeing the epidemic, but the migrant workers who were clustered together and so on, and having essentially little support from the health authorities, saw a massive epidemic. So in Singapore they are like two completely different situations. Normal people don't notice the epidemic. Migrant workers are heavily affected. My suspicion is that India will get into the same kind of scenario. So some parts that where the app could make a difference, some parts in which the app will just not work. And what happens at this point, honestly, with the exponential expansion in some areas and some areas that are safe is a difficult question. Maybe, but I definitely think the app has value.
Maybe we should have a separate colloquium on India's case, and probably this is on our schedule. So there was another question by Ralph.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay, so thank you very much for the very nice introduction, and especially I like that you gave the point of view of the epidemiologist to this whole story, because these apps are mainly discussed as far as security is concerned in the public debate. And this is, in spite of what I just said, I would like to ask a question about the security, because what is being discussed and also what you mentioned is mainly how one can protect everyone from kind of governments or from Big Brother, and how to ensure privacy, which I understand is in the in the forefront of all app developers. However, I can see only many ways how an ill-intentioned individual can do harm with these apps. So for example, imagine that some ill-intentioned person places a phone or one of these dongles next to the entrance, say, of the police station or next to the tax collectors or at the entrance of a company, which is a competitive company or something. And some days later puts I'm positive into the same smartphone and the whole police will be quarantined or the whole company will be locked down. So I can even imagine that individuals can do a lot of harm with these kind of apps. And I would like to ask, are there any ways to protect against these misuses?
So what deeply annoys me is that this is the right question. And this question has essentially never been asked. I think the only people who really wondered about this question are maybe some people in the Italian working group and one French cryptographer, Serge Vaudenet, actually who works in Lausanne, who came out with a thorough examination of one of the proposals, DP3T, that is one of the first ones to be ready and so to have a white paper to discuss. And he found several security attacks that were possible, including a special attacks of this kind. So for example, I have a rival in whatever sense and they want to quarantine him or her for 14 days. Can I do this? So the problem is that unfortunately the discussion has been completely on the privacy side, but there are several attacks against other individuals or the government itself that has not been discussed. My personal position is that, so to be clear about the debate, centralized, decentralized version, it is, I think, completely uninformed. I am for the decentralized part in the best possible world. And for the next epidemic, I suggest to think carefully about a decentralized system. But for now, in a hurry, I do not see any way that the decentralized system can protect against this kind of attacks. Because essentially, you as a government that would like to check them or even to investigate them, you have no power. Public health authorities would like to stop them. They have no power because they do not know anything about the system. So the issue is that for this kind of attacks, there is limited protection. The limited protection is on the centralized side because you can investigate who actually reported you, and these people can be traced back by, for example, human contact tracers. So if I think I received a notification, the notification is clearly mistaken, I can call the health authorities, tell them, please do human contact tracing, the classical way with people that come to me and come to the guy who told that infected me. And I have to be clear, in these cases, when you are infectious or you at least are being infected, privacy in public health does not exist. It has never existed, and this is out of the question. So if you are infectious, your privacy is gone. This is a public health requirement. In some countries, this is a public health requirement. So I'm not saying something that is against the current privacy debate. It's something stable in the realm of public health. Many communicable diseases have to be communicated actually to the public health authority. You just cannot say, oh, this individual is infectious, but I do not know. So human contact tracers have all the right to go and talk to these individuals and try to understand if there is actually been an infection. And eventually, if there is something dangerous, the health authorities could even have a system in place. The problem is that this system is not easy to put in place in a short time. And as you say, it has not been discussed. And I think this is one of very, very important questions that has completely been forgotten.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So, there is another question from Guido, then I think this is there is another. So first of all, there is another question on contact tracing. So how many contacts will be traced for every new positive? And how many tests they should be able to perform in order for this strategy to work?
So the consideration is not so much about the tests by themselves, but is what is the kind of social and economic cost that you want to face. So there's a trade-off between keeping many people in quarantine, even with a low risk or a low or low scores, of course, and slowing down the epidemic. So several scenarios, actually, if I may go back. So here you see several scenarios. This is a null scenario where you don't use the app. This is a scenario where you, for example, you quarantine only the first contacts and the households. A scenario where you quarantine the households and so on. So you are quarantining more and more people in these scenarios or in a different way, test-based or not test-based. And the way you do it changes the trade-off between having a high number of people in quarantine at every time and slowing down the epidemic. So it is really it's not a simple question, because it's a matter what is that matters in at a given point of the epidemic. Is it to stop the virus as much as
That's where you need the agent-based modeling, essentially.
Agent-based modeling and better algorithms, because there is a lot of risk scoring on the network and on individual cases to do. There are lots of things that are just now being discussed for the first time to do risk scoring. And there are several people who are actually working on doing, for example, message passing for better risk scoring and so on. So it's a complex question that does not have a simple answer, because it really depends what are your goals in terms of how much you should slow down the epidemic and how many people you should quarantine. For the moment, I can tell you that all the models that we have here are a bit so they stop the epidemic very effectively. They do not need testing, because many of these models actually work on symptoms, but they keep a huge number of people at home, like 1/4 of the population at home in some of these models during the peak of the epidemic. So they are satisfactory from an epidemiological point of view, but maybe from an economic one, people would like something better, and there are better options. Just a matter to work them out.
So we are running very, very late, but Guido has another question I would like to ask.
Comment. Thank you very much for a very nice talk. Maybe more on the epidemiology of COVID. I mean, R and R0 are averages, but maybe one person will infect one other and one person will infect 500 others. So these heavy tail effects might be very important. And that might mean that restricting those opportunities for heavy tails is a smart initiative. So some studies that I've seen on Germany, for example, show that the most effective single intervention was banning large gatherings. Closing schools, which is hugely disruptive, almost no effect. Can you comment on these things?
So about closing schools, again, there is a different issue. It is different vulnerability for this, different susceptibility and infections for different age classes. So I agree that schools do not look like a big problem. About the over dispersion, yes, it is. So it has been suggested since the beginning that there is over dispersion. It looks quite likely. The problem is that no one has, I think, good estimates for how large this over dispersion is. In terms of the contact tracing, the issue with over dispersion is essentially that you... So actually, there are multiple issues with over dispersion, but it's not clear how these issues impact, to be honest, contact tracing. In the sense that you have, of course, more. So you have some individuals that actually will have lots of contacts that will be quarantined uselessly because they are actually not so infectious. And you have some individuals that instead should be quarantined even earlier, and you don't know. But if there's no way to know, this is quite useless. From the point of view of mass gatherings, it's a different matter. So the point is there are two dispersions. One is in the infectiousness of the individuals. So maybe some individuals are actually not so infectious. So there is a distribution that is heavy-tailed in terms of infectiousness itself. So the probability of infecting for any given contact. And there is a heavy-tail in the distribution of contacts. And the two combine to form this over dispersion that you're talking about. Of course, mass gatherings contribute to the over dispersion in the tail of the number of contacts. This has not been sufficiently studied, I think, until now, and is something that could be studied even within the app. So we should be able to collect data and actually observe this effect directly, because we cannot observe individual infections, but we can observe the number of contacts of individuals have. And we can observe if actually this makes a difference and how to intervene on that. So there is one part that is essentially unobservable. To me, it's not clear what are the consequences, although it could be important. One part is instead maybe observable and could be worked out from essentially app record. So from the kind of information that is extracted from the app.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we should close here because we are really running late. I thank Luca again for this very, very interesting talk. I just want to mention that while we were following this talk, I received a box from one of our associates of ICTP from China who decided to send masks to Italy. So this is a very nice kind a sign of kindness and a sense of how much ICTP is felt like a home for many scientists around the world. So thank you all for listening, for participating. Thank again, Luca, for being with us, and we hope to hope you in person soon.
Yeah, I hope so. We all hope so, probably.
Okay.
Ciao. See you. Have a nice weekend.
Bye-bye.